Shabbat Shalom, Mishpacha. This is Rabbi Simon, and we are here at another Sabbath, and it's been a pretty interesting, eventful week. But before we go into the week's dealings, let us give thanks to God for bringing us through the week. We want to thank you, Abba Father, for bringing us through the week, for providing for our needs, for providing for our food, clothing and shelter, and for providing for our travels to and fro, back from home and back again. And Father, I thank you that you provide for the needs of those that were sick and those that are healed, and that you continue to look after the children and people of Israel all across the world, and those that are sincere to you, that you look after those. And that I pray for peace in all the surrounding nations of Israel and for the peace of Israel itself. I thank you, Father, that you placed us in time as this so we can watch the events as they unfold, as we see prophecy unfold before our eyes. I thank you for that. We're very, very fortunate people that we can see this and understand what's going on. Yet the prophets wanted to see this time, but they didn't see it, and yet we see it. So I give you thanks, and I thank you for everything that you do for us, for our people, and for the world round about. I thank you, and I bless your holy name. Amen. We amen. And we begin with a joke to lighten the air. There was a priest, a pastor, and a rabbi. They were sitting together, and it turned out that they all had a similar problem, squirrels in their attic. And the priest said, when we realized what the problem was, we hired an exterminator who sealed off the church and fumigated. Nevertheless, 2 weeks later, the squirrels were back. The pastor said, we had this issue too. We got humane traps, caught the squirrels, and released them 20 miles away. Nevertheless, 2 weeks later, the squirrels were back. We had the same problem, said the rabbi. When we realized that what was going on, we had a meeting of the trustees, made the squirrels full members of the congregation, and now we only see them on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. Now, with that kind of leads me into the war in Gaza. And before we go into the war in Gaza, I think it's important to understand where I'm coming from, and what I'm going to say is going to be very, very relevant both to the time now, to the prophecy in the past, and the prophecy in the present and the future. First, you know the war in Russia is still going on with Ukraine, and there's no stop to that. I don't know if you know, but my sister-in-law is actually from Ukraine, and she lives in the UK. And I was talking to my brother, and he told me that one of his relatives from the wife's side, he's actually been, recruited in the army. So he has to go to war with Russia. And apparently the law in Ukraine is that if you're under 60, you can be recruited in the army and you have to go and fight their war. So that's basically where my family is with the war in concern. So, I mean, that war continues unabated with, America and the allies providing the weapons and armament that Russia continues to destroy at the other end. Now, I don't know what kind of news you're getting in America, whether you are getting any real news or is just, what they are told to tell you on the TV and the so-called media. But here is what the news is so far in Gaza. So what happens basically is that on the Gazan front, I think, I'm not quite sure what they have been telling you, and it's something to think about, whatever it is that they're telling you. Because I'm pretty sure that what they are telling you is probably not true. And the reality is this, that right now, from what I know, that there have been several Israeli tanks that have been destroyed in Gaza that they haven't told you about. More than 30, by the way. And more than 30 vehicles, armored vehicles, have also been destroyed. Several soldiers have been killed. And this is unprecedented. This has never happened before, by the way. And what it turns out to be, or at least it appears to be, that the fighters on the Palestinian side, they have been training for this war for a time now, and it's likely that they've been trained by, or with the money of, the Persian Empire, or Iran as we know it. So it's also likely that they were planning for this war for maybe more than 5 years, which is happening now. So the outcome of what's going on right now is, so far, is pretty bleak for Israel, because I think they have already lost 60 hostages. They killed 60 of their own hostages while trying to destroy the tunnels. And the tunnels that the Palestinian fighters have dug, they are so wide that the vehicles can go through them. And what the Palestinian fighters have done, they have made these homemade rockets, which cost about $300, and they use those to blow up the Merkava tanks that Israel has, that cost about maybe $10 to $15 million. So you can imagine the damage that they are doing to the Israeli military. Israel's dome also has failed on one occasion that intercepts missiles, and that failed to intercept missiles. It did most of the time, it intercepted missiles, and other times it didn't, because the barrage of missiles was so much, it failed at one point. At one point there was a glitch. Nobody knows if it was the system was hacked, or whether it was jammed, or what happened. And it started to fire. It couldn't intercept missiles, and it started to fire missiles on the cities of Israel. And so people were getting missiles fired from the dome. I'm pretty sure they haven't told you that in your countries. So at one point, a missile was fired from Yemen. Yemen has got involved in the war. At one point, the missile was fired from Yemen, and America had to intercept it. They had their cruise ships over there. They had their destroyers and their big aircraft carrier, and they used their missile system to intercept the Yemen missile. Had they not done that, it would have landed directly on the city intended and probably caused a lot of destruction. So I think that the Israelis should really be thankful to the Americans at this point. And I would say this as an assessment, and you can all do your assessment as well. And my assessment is this, that Benjamin Netanyahu has really played a wild card, and his wild card is going to land him and many Israeli politicians into a lot of trouble, because first, several hostages have been killed. Second, there's immense amount of damage on the Palestinian front. You know, the buildings have been destroyed, hospitals have been bombed, schools, infrastructure destroyed, and you know, they might say that it's because there's fighters there, and it may well be that there are some fighters hiding in hospital. Sure, I'm not saying that that's a deniable fact. There may be fighters hiding there, but I think that the question that we have to ask is, if there are 1,000 patients in a hospital and 10 enemy fighters hiding there for whatever reason, they're not holding the hospital to hostage, but they're just hiding there maybe to save their lives, would you bomb the hospital and destroy and kill 1,000 civilians for the sake of killing 10 enemy fighters? I think that's something that they have to assess, and that's just my point of view, that is it right to do that? And again, this is something clearly the military planners in Israel have decided to go ahead with, and then they're trying to deny it. But unfortunately, the facts on the ground dictate otherwise. So that's something that they have to contend with. All I can say right now, that Israel has a lot of conscript military. They are not all trained fighters. Let's, you know, come to the realization that without America's support right now, they would be in a very difficult situation. That is the honest truth on the ground. Now, where is God in all of this? Listen, I told you before, and I'm not going to sugarcoat it. I'm going to tell you, as a person from the children of Israel, that when you as a nation commit violations of the Torah, God's protection, God's hedge of protection is removed. That you already know about. And I think that we are seeing the effects of that. I think there needs to be a lot of soul search in those people, in Israel, a lot of soul searching, and maybe a lot of repentance that needs to be done. And maybe, you know, similarly, I think whenever an enemy attacks you, you have to ask the question, have I done some violation against God? Is he sending me an enemy because I did something wrong? Not because the enemy wants to kill you. That's just a barometer. That's a barometer to tell you that something is not right within yourself. So that's where we are with that. Okay? So I'm not, you know, for and against. I'm not into that for and against type of thing. But I will tell you this much, that number of prominent Jews will be leaving Israel to go back to America or wherever they came from, because they do not feel safe in Israel. The other bad thing that happened there is continuing to happen. You have some settlers, Jewish settlers, that live in what are called occupied areas, and they hold up ordinary Palestinians on a gun, and they say to them, confess that our religion is the best religion. And then they hold a gun to their head. And then the Palestinian person, whoever, man, woman, child, has to say that before they allow them to go. Now you tell me, a lot of people in the Western world are so ignorant of these things that they used to say that, Islam is a religion of the sword, and, you know, it converted people by force. But what you don't realize is John Hyrcanus, one of the kings of Israel, actually converted people by force. A whole, you know, whole clan of people he converted by force. And the Muslims learned this from the Jews, to convert by force and to expel people. That's exactly what he did. He gave an ultimatum to expel the people or convert to Judaism. And they converted. And what was the result? The result was that you got the Judean king, or the so-called Herod, mentioned in the New Testament, who came and done his dirty deeds. You know all of those dirty deeds. You can read about them in the New Testament. So my point is this, that forceful conversion always has a problem at the end. It's not a great thing to do. And similarly, you know, the Islamic Empire followed suit with that, where they needed to convert people who they deemed as enemy. They did it too. So, and other places, they didn't have to. Some people automatically converted into Islam. Others didn't. But, you know, when they conquered nations, some they forced to convert. Like in India, maybe. Similarly, you know, everything is not roses, you know, a bed of roses. You know, Islam has this good and has its bad, just like every other religious and faith. And Islam also, you know, there's a brotherhood, kind of brotherhood. And we find a lot of black people in America who convert into Islam because they feel a brotherhood, and because they don't find that in Christianity. So Torah itself teaches us to be a family structure. We know it's like a tribes, you know, rallying around the priesthood, or vice versa, the priesthood around the tribes, you know, holding Israel up. So I would continue to pray for peace for the people of Israel, And for the Palestinians, that a malleable solution can be found between the two people to coexist until the Messiah shows up. You know, I think that is I would say the easiest thing to say. I mean, you know, the Iranian Jews, they don't like the Israeli politicians one little bit. They want them out of Israel. They want them to dismantle their government because they see them as inherently wrong in trying to take Israel's land by force, because you're not allowed to take by force according to the Torah. Also, I told you before and I stick to my same thing, Gaza never belonged to Israel. Gaza was part of, first of all, it belonged to an ancient Canaanite people. From Canaanite people, it went to different groups of people. You know, in time of King David, he only ruled it for a very small bit, but it was, you know, it was conquered by the Assyrian Empire and then by the Persian Empire. And, you know, we had, and if you remember, if you go back before the Persian, before the Assyrian, before King David, originally, in the time of Israel being in Egypt, it was ruled by the Philistines. Philistines are the actual and the real owners of the land of Gaza. Okay, the Strip Gaza, as you call it. They own that piece of property. Now, it is not part of Greater Israel, and it never was, and it never will be. So let's get that straight. Because God has not permitted Israel to conquer areas that belong to, you know, that belong to the sons of Esau. Similarly, God has not allowed us to conquer areas belonging to Philistines or somebody else. Now, is it right? Is it right for me as a person, force, military, is it right for me to go in and bombard everybody and kill them and take the property? I'm not so sure, you know, I'm going to vouch for that. I'm not so sure. But, you know, maybe you have different opinions. That's where we are with that. As we stand with the land of Gaza, you know, surrounding Israel and Palestinians, etc. It's really a kind of messy situation, and you know, at the end of the day, there's going to have to be a solution found. What some people are saying is that gas and oil have been found in the Gaza area, and energy contracts have been issued out to some individuals in Israel, and that, you know, this whole war is actually surrounded around this energy that has been found, and that people are saying that Israel does not want this energy to go into the hands of the Gazans, and they want to keep this energy for themselves, hence why all this war and everything happening. Now, I don't know how true that is, but that's what basically the news in the East. So, going on to our Parsha today is on the Parsha Torah portion, chapter 23 of the book of Genesis, Bereshith, where it says, verse 1, Sarah lived 127 years, these were the years of the life of Sarah. And then it says, so Sarah died in Kiriath Arba, that is Hebron in the land of Canaan, and Abraham came to mourn for Sarah and to weep for her. Then Abraham stood up from before his dead and spoke to the sons of Heth, saying, I'm a foreigner and a sojourner among you. Give me property for a burial place among you, that I may bury my dead out of my sight. And the sons of Heth answered Abraham, saying to him, hear us, my master, you are a prince of Elohim among us. Bury your dead in the choices of our burial places. None of us will withhold from you this burial place, that you may bury your dead. So here, clearly the story, there's two threads running. One thread is that Sarah's age is mentioned, 127 years, a ripe age, a great life, fruitful life, and then even to give birth to a son that was a promised son, for because of whom we are here today. Okay, without him, there would be no Israel. So because of him, Jacob, and thus the 12 tribes. So that's, you know, the great, you know, that's the great detail in there. Also, it talks about Abraham, you know, burying her in a plot of land and asking for the plot and something that he buys and purchases at a good price, 400 shekels of silver at that time, and then, you know, he buries his spouse, his wife there, and subsequently that site is used for other burials as well. So it's not about the burial. Then it, in chapter 24, it talks about Abraham being of age, well advanced in age, and then, you know, God tells him that it's now time for you to go, and you know, kind of things continue from there, and another another bride, a bride has to be found for his son Isaac, for which we find that, you know, Abraham entrusts his one of his wife's sons, Eliezer, who is actually son of one of his wives, and Mashach is her name, and he sends him to find a bride back to the family of Abraham, which is kind of interesting story. If you read it, you can go back to Genesis and read all about it. I think it's also safe to say that within this story, what we find is that, of course, Eliezer goes back to Abraham's family in what was Iraq in those old days, ancient days, and then he finds the wife for Rivka, Rebecca. He finds Rebecca as a wife for Isaac, and then she leaves her household and comes to live and be a wife to Isaac. Okay, in the old days, it didn't have to, you know, there was a ceremony conducted, but there was a marriage in the form where dowry was sent. Abraham sent 10 camels of dowry. They took the dowry, they accepted the marriage, and a contract would be sent saying that, you know, I want you to be my wife. And then if the lady, the girl, accepted, then that marriage is done. Then she would just come and a little celebration takes place. Maybe they, you know, kill a goat, maybe they, you know, kill a cow, cattle, etc. And then they do a little party and get together, and then that is a marriage. By the way, that's the ancient model of marriage. There was no informal, you know, calling of various people. It was just the oath, or the people, the, you know, the message was sent to the girl's family, to the girl herself. If she's of age, then she would just have to say, yes, I like to be the wife of such and such, and the marriage would be, it would be betrothed. She would be betrothed and married and automatically become the wife of such and such person. Anyway, that's the old model. And that model, by the way, in Torah is still at effect. I would say those who live in Torah is still in effect for them. Now, moving on, coming back from away from this a little bit, and we'll look at the irony of the joke I gave you of the squirrels. You know, the squirrels coming back. Isn't it similar? Isn't it an ironic that Gaza, you know, Israel is trying to pay. Israel is offering $160 billion or whatever is the debt of Egypt for them to clear their debt to IMF, and saying to them that, can you house the 2 million people in the desert, in your desert, in tents, and let the UN feed them, you know, as they did in the past. And Israel is saying to clear the land of Gaza. That's what Israel is proposing to Egypt. So isn't that ironic, the squirrel joke? You know, the squirrels coming back after 2 weeks. Don't you think that if they did that and succeeded in, you know, in making Egypt this offer and Egypt accepted, don't you think that the squirrels would be back to fight another war? Think about it. I think this is a, you know, a battle that's not going to just stop like that. This is not, you know, it may seem like a solution. I'm not so sure it will be the solution. But anyhow, that's where that is. Coming back to us, our lives generally, if you remember what I told you, is that, you know, every night when you go to bed, I want you to visualize, imagine you have $3 million and you're going to spend that upon you, you know, on yourself. You're going to invest some of it and spend the rest on yourself. I ask you to do that simply because I think that it will be helpful. It will be something that you can do, and it will be beneficial in how shall we say it, into bringing that money into your lives. But you have to be consistent. You have to do it every day. It's not a one-time event or a maybe one-week event. You have to do it every day, consistently, before you go to bed. And I also said to you that before you go to bed, I want you to write 30 times. And if those of you can't write 30 times, at least write 10 times what your desire is. Maybe pick three desires that you wish to have and write them out 10 times each and then go to bed. Of course, you know, with that $3 million imagination that you have 3 million spend, and maybe you buy the M3 laptop that just came out, maybe you buy iPhone 15, I don't know. Whatever you desire, you do that in your bedtime. And that way you build your imagination and you build your rapport with what you're desiring to bring into this life, into this world, into the 3D. Whatever you intend to bring in will come in only when you do it consistently and with a knowing and effort. That's the only effort you have to do, is to do it consistently. If you do it consistently, that thing which you desire will come to you. If you don't do it consistently, you know, if you do it here and there and miss days out and then do it again and then miss days, then it's not consistent, then it will elude you. So be faithful to your desire, even though it's unseen, but it will be seen. And don't stop. Don't look for BBLs, or don't look for signs, and don't look for miracles about when it's going to happen. Simply aim for what you want and don't stop until it happens. Until the day you get that in your hand, in your bank, you continue to do it. Okay, that's how you should work it. So that's that side. And it's very important that you train your brain, train your mind to do that. And the more you do it, the more trained it will be, and the faster it will come to you. Now, I did explain, I think in maybe one of my other talks, that you can do the affirmation. You know, you might be doing the affirmation, I have, and then whatever you desire, you know, I have $3 million, for instance. But you may also want to loop it with, why do I have $3 million? With an ask formation, like a question. Because our brains respond to questions faster. And that is because, remember, sometimes when you say, oh, I forgot to where I put my car key, you know, you put your car key somewhere, you forget, and you say, oh, I forgot. And you ask yourself, where did I put my car key? As a question. And within 5-10 minutes of that question, maybe even less, your brain responds with, oh, it's over there somewhere, and you go and you find it. So your brain responds to questions. So these ask formation or question you formulate within your affirmation. So if you say, I have $3 million, it is also good to say, why do I have $3 million? And that will bring it in quicker. Okay, so that will speed it up. But you got to remember what I told you. 10 minutes, you know, break down your hour. This is what I would do. I would break down the hour into 20-minute segments, 3 20-minute segments, 20, 20, 20. That's 60. 60 is an important number. 6 is an important number. 6 is the number of Venus. 6 is the number of wealth. And also, Venus is also the number of love as well. So if you break it down into 20, 20, 20, then you rotate your affirmation for 20 minutes each for 1 hour. So if you had 3 affirmations, you rotate one 20 minutes, then the other 20 minutes, then the other 20 minutes. So you rotate them like that, and you got your whole hour. If you can do that, then you'll bring it in faster. Robotically affirming will bring it in faster. And of course, you know, you imagine that's coming to you, it will be with you. So remember to do that. Now, other than that, I think that let's continue to petition for the people of Middle East, people of Israel, people of Gaza, and, you know, Palestinian regions. Let's continue to pray and uphold these people in prayer, so that a peaceful solution can be found where they can both coexist in peace without bloodshed and without, you know, violence. I think that at any level, it doesn't matter how strong Israel claims to be, as I told you, it's going to become a protected war. It's going to be a bloody war, and you don't want, you know, people to be killed on both sides. Yeah, maybe, you know, a lot of people are questioning this war across the world, and they're asking questions. Is, you know, they are saying that the military or Israel's leaders have been a little heavy-handed. Now, I don't run the country, and I don't live there either, so I don't have any comment on that part. But my comment is simply this, that wherever there are Torah violations, wherever Torah is violated, there the recompense comes from God. So this is, I think, a very, very important comment that I'm going to leave you with. And I'm going to say have a wonderful Shabbat and a wonderful week ahead. Shabbat shalom to you, and shalom.